Het jou man ooit gesê, gaan speel dat ek net rus kan kry vir my siel nie? Huh? Anybody in the house? Huh? Did anybody ever say, I wish I can just find some rest for my soul? Huh? You know? Most people only get it when it says R.I.P. Hmm? Isn't it funny? You go through the graveyard and you see how many tombstones says, rest in peace. Huh? Now he has found peace. In other words, everybody's running without peace and rest till the day they die, they find rest. Jesus didn't say, come unto me that I can kill you, that you can find rest. He said, come unto me because you labor and are heavy laden, and you will find rest for your soul. Then he says, the way to find rest is, learn of me. I am meek and lowly of heart, and you shall find rest for your soul. So if I change to meekness and lowliness of heart, I will find rest for my soul. Jesus walk around fighting in the street, fighting with his disciples, fighting with everybody, or was Jesus gentle and kind? Hmm? What type of Jesus do you expect? Hmm? A fighting Jesus or a meek and gentle Jesus? If you pray to him, what do you expect? Who is coming to you? Who's listening to your prayers? Who's going to answer your prayers? A hard dictator or a meek and gentle shepherd? Come on, the Bible says in Ezekiel 34, I've got it against the shepherds because with hardness they rule and they fight amongst the sheep and they kill the sheep and they drink the milk and they clothe themselves with the wool, but they will not heal the sick and they will not visit those that are, you know, gone out from the fold. And he said, but I myself will come as the great shepherd of the sheep. I am the good shepherd that will lay down my life for my sheep. How many would love to find some rest, especially in your home? Husbands and wives, wives and husbands, children and parents, uncles and aunts, grandmothers and grandfathers, you know, mothers-in-laws and daughters-in-laws and brothers-in-law. How would you like to just have rest? Four. James chapter 4. From whence come wars and fightings among you? I hope the word's going to speak to you, rip you apart, jump in you, and bring forth truth. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your lusts that war in your members? When God gave me the scripture, I said, Lord, but how do you bring this together? God said, this is not lust of women, lust of money, lust of other things. This is lust of proving you right. From whence come wars and fightings? From the lust that war in your members. The lust to prove I'm right. That's why I fight. Annalise has got something there from the message. Let's hear.
Where do you think all these appalling wars and quarrels come from? Do you think they just happen? Think again. They come about because you want your own way and fight for it deep inside yourself.
Oh my goodness. See, I didn't read the message. I read the King James. That doesn't say anything like that. And God said to me, the lust is people want to prove they right. That's why there's fightings. That's the lust. So the biggest lust in a person is, I want to be right. That's why I want to prove I'm going to fight. Okay, why fight? Verse 2. God's going to come through. It's going to come through. You lust and you have not. You kill and you desire to have and you cannot obtain. You fight and you war, yet you have not because you ask not. Then you ask and you receive not because you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your lust. In other words, God says people pray this way. Father, I pray that you just work in my wife's life. What you're praying is, God, help her to see that I'm the right one. Woman, God, would you work in my husband that he will just see me for a change? What you're saying is, God, let my husband realize I am the controlling spirit and I am right. You Is there anybody, maybe by television, send us an SMS or an email? God says, this is the war. This is the lust that I'm talking about in James chapter 4. Why do you want to fight? Why do you want a war? Let's return to the resting. Let's turn back to Hebrews, just the previous book, Hebrews 4. Let's step off the chapter because none of people think I'm talking to them. I read it in one of Ian Bounce's books. He says, how do you know a preacher heard from God when he's speaking to you? Okay. Hebrews chapter 3 says, and to whom swear ye that they should not enter into his rest, but to them that believe not. Remember the asking and don't receive? So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. So when you pray, you must believe. Let us therefore fear, lest the promise being left us of entering into his rest. The promise is there that you can have rest. Jesus said, come and you can have rest. Do you think if you're stressed up, you got rest? Hey, do you think if you're stressed up, you have rest? 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 Right. Just thinking, you know, maybe I could talk to somebody here today. Verse 2. For unto us was the gospel preached. Listen to the words. The gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. Say, I want the rest. I'm hearing the gospel today, and I'm not going to miss it like they did. Okay, now, the same thing is said in Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10, verse 16 says, the gospel was preached unto them, but they believed not. As Isaiah said, who believed our report, and to whom was the arm of the Lord revealed? Verse 17, so then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word. Jump back to verse 6. The righteousness which is of faith speaks. In other words, I must hear. Thank you. Secondly, I must speak what I heard. I must believe that which I said will come to pass. Is that moral, is it? I think there's a word like this. And maybe I could be right. In Proverbs 18, verse 21. It says something like this, if I'm right. Death and life, and I will be right, is in the power of the tongue. And that he that useth it shall eat the fruit. Not can, not may. He shall eat the fruit of what he says. You know, but with God, the things... there's a time delay, it seems like it. Many times you say stuff and think you're getting away with it. And then all of a sudden one day stuff doesn't work out anymore. And you don't think it's what you said because you said it for 20 years. But the last month you tried to come right. But you never made right what you said over 20 years. So we got to come to a place where we say, oh God, my tongue. Whatever I said that wasn't bringing glory to your name, that wasn't edifying, that wasn't by faith, that wasn't in belief, I cancel it. I ask forgiveness. I pray that you cleanse this tongue of mine, this ears of mine, this heart of mine. I want to hear the word of God. I want to receive the word of God. I want to have it in my heart and in my mouth. I want to speak by faith, and I want to see supernatural positive results in my life, in my home, in my family, in my body, in my finances, in my marriage, in my family, in my children. I want to see the results. Results of God, because I hear and I speak what God says. Bless you, brother. So let's look back Remember when God said to those Hebrew guys, there's a land of promise? This is more or less what we read in Hebrews 4. They had the promise to enter into that rest, the land where they will not work. It'll just flow with milk and honey. Remember the story? And they came to the land, and 10 spies says, we can't take the land. 2 says, we can. If God says we can, we can. God says, then for 40 days, you spied the land. Now for 40 years, you're going to dwell in the desert. I'm going to see to it that all of you are dead except the next generation will enter the land. Remember the story? Now let's pick it up in Deuteronomy 1, where Moses referred to it just before they enter. I think it'll be a good place to go to. Man, I'm so excited. Be ye doers of the word. Now, Deuteronomy 1 is where Moses tells the story of how the spies went in, how they came back, how God gave the promises, how they refused to take the promises, how they rebelled against him. Verse 27 more or less says, no, verse 25 says they took of the fruit of the land. The end of the verse says it's a good land, you know. Verse 27 says, but you were peevish and discontented in your tents and said, because the Lord hated us, he brought us forth to let die us in the, you know, desert. Verse 28, to what are we going up? Our brethren have made our hearts melt, saying the people are bigger and taller than we are. Remember, Numbers 12 through 14, the cities are great and fortified, and we saw the giants, remember. Verse 29, this is where we pick up our story today. Then I say to you, dread not, neither be afraid of them. Now you got to listen, because this is a prophetic word that God dropped in my heart on Thursday, and I'm bringing it to you like a floodgate from heaven. Listen, the Lord your God who goes before you, he will fight for you. Just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. And in the wilderness we have seen how the Lord your God bore you as a man carries his son. In all the way that you went until you come to this place. Yet in spite of this word you did not believe. Did not trust, rely on, and remain steadfast to the Lord your God. There's Hebrews 4. There's Romans 10. How many see it and say, Lord, I'm not going to fall for that. Okay, here's the word. The Lord your God. He. Help me. Will go before you. Thank you for that whistle. He will fight for you. How many remember the number 13's banner? How many? Okay, a third of you. Let me tell the story. When I got saved, you know, there was this one preacher that I sort of idolized. You know, and I went to learn from him, and he taught me a lot, and he always told me, remember, son, you give God the glory. You don't take it and walk away with it, you know. But, you know, he was a stubborn type of man, and he was like me. He liked to work on cars. Now, if you work on cars, there's two spanners that's very important. That's a number 10 and a number 13. Kid number 10 and number 13, okay. You can do a lot with a 10 and a 13. You know, in the old days, it was a half inch. Okay, the woman, if you don't understand it, just think of your needlework scissors. It'll be like a 13 spanner. All right. So this guy came home one day, put on his overall and went in to work on one of his cars. And he came in and he had this board against his garage wall, you know, where the spanners hang, and you know, then you paint them and you can see when one is not there and stuff. So he looked in, the number 13 spanner is not there. So he came into the house and he screamed at his wife, like she was working with the spanners. Is there any married people? Okay. Hey, where's my number 13 spanner? She did what a good wife does. I'm not working on your cars. He did what a good husband does. Are you screaming at me? You started this. And if you think you can scream like your father, I can scream like my mother. So he walks off his way, she walks off her way, and he slams the door like trying to fit it into another doorpost. You know the story? Okay, don't have to put up your hands, all of you, but you know the story of the door slamming. Brackets, Carlos Ortiz told the story. He says, you know, when God told him and his wife to love one another, he said he came in one day and his wife was the angry one. He was the meek one. He said, but he just couldn't take it anymore. And his wife slammed the door. Bam! He opened the door. He said, honey, come here. He said, let me help you. Bam! He said, and then she would normally take something and throw it. He said, honey, that's cool. Let me help you. So he picked it up. Bam! He said, something else, my honey? I said, okay. Brackets closed. But this guy says, he left town, preached at a certain place, and she was praying, and she walked past the garage, and she looked in where the spanners was hanging. She said, God, this is such a bear of a husband. You know, not the teddy bear of Elvis, bear, you know, grizzly. Says, God says, next time he screams, love him. She says, huh, you come here and love him when he screams. God gave her this scripture. Said, the Lord goes before you. He will fight for you. She says, in a marriage, God says, love him. Yes, he came back weekend. Two of her sons was working in the garage. Now the 10 and the 13 was gone. So he came home, put on his overall, went in, came into the house and said, do you know what happened to my 10 and 13 spanner? She looked at him, she says, I really don't know. And he raised his voice, he said, don't look so innocent. Where is my 13 and 10 spanner? She looked at him, she said, have I told you lately that I love you? No, she didn't. She said, I love you. He said, listen, don't come with love stories. Where's my 13 and 10 spanner? She came closer and she looked at him with that eyes before they got married. She said, I love you. He said, don't come with love. I want my 13. It's your sons. You got that one? Remember when they're naughty, it's your sons. When they're cool, it's my sons. You know, when they achieve something, my son did well. When they're naughty, your son that you brought up. Remember? Why do you laugh? Did you get it too? Okay. So she came close and he screamed. And she said, I love you. He said, don't come with this love. She said, I really love you. He said, don't come with this love thing. She said, but I love you. He said, yeah. She said, can I hug you? He said, well, if you want to. Okay. Right. Will you try it? Or will you be stubborn and fight for the rest of your life? This is not what I was going to preach. But seeing that we're on the subject, I say to my sons all the time, and I say it to other young people when they talk to me, I say, when is somebody going to break the cycle of history of family fights? Who's going to stand up for the cause of righteousness in marriages and say, this is the last generation of family fights. I'm gonna be responsible for breaking the cycle. From now on, I'm gonna bring peace in the home. Not one person can fight with themselves. But I'm the man, so am I. Can you shut up? Yes, I can. So can you. What does it matter if you win the fight? It's like this rat race of the human society. If you come first, you know what you are? The first rat. The number one rat. What did you achieve when you won the fight? Absolutely nothing. You caused a lot of hurt in your house, in your children, and the next generation grow up with complexes. And then they cause fights, and the next generation grow up with complexes. Till somebody decides, this is the last generation of fights. Okay, how did God fight for them? Exodus 14. Okay, so the Hebrew children left the land of Egypt into the desert. There's the Red Sea. Wham-bitty-bam, no surfboards. Okay, behind them, Pharaoh and his best chariots of war, you know. Verse 12, didn't we not tell you in Egypt, let us alone? Is it the same story as Deuteronomy 1? Yeah. Let us serve the Egyptians, for it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. Moses told the people, yeah. Fear not. Yeah. Hey, I'm talking to you. Yeah. Stand still. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. See the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians you have seen today, you shall never see again. How would you like never to see another battle, never to see another war, never to see another fight? How would you like peace? Yes. Verse 14. The Lord will fight for you, and you shall hold your peace and remain at rest. Oh my goodness, somebody shout. Are you in the house? I must hear, I must speak, I must believe. The Lord will fight for you, who goes before you. Okay, what did Moses say? Fear not. Can you help me? Stand. Still, that's a lot of fighting. That's a lot of fighting. Stand still. Fear not. Stand still. What did he say? See the salvation of the Lord. Huh? That God will work. For you, man. What must you do? Hold your peace. Hold it. Hold it. Hold it. Hold it. 10. Peace. Stay at rest. Remember the army days? Tension. At ease, tension, at ease, tension, at ease. Stand at ease. If you're in the Navy, stand at rest. What does it mean? You can now move around a little. But you can't go over the parade ground. But you are free to move around a little. You can now talk and move your arms, you know. When you're at rest or at ease, you still stand still. It's just your legs are apart. Tension, work, then stand at rest. Can lose your arms, can walk around, but you still stand on the parade ground. You still hold your ground. Because any minute you can get a command. Tangent, right. Left turn, forward, march, left, right, left, right, 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 right. New South Africa, you know nothing about it. Let's go to the same story in 2 Chronicles 20. This is all stuff we know, but it's going to get deeper and more intense as we go on. And by the end of the meeting, we're going to say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, great battle. Three armies come against one king. You know, they start praying to the Lord. Let's look at verse 12. Oh, our God. Now, every word is God weighed. I didn't look for it. I didn't search for it. I just sat down and wrote down the scriptures that I'm going to use. I didn't look for it. I didn't look it up. God just said, go speak. I sat down, wrote the scriptures, and that was it. I'm serious. So you better take every scripture is from God. Listen, O our God, will you not exercise judgment upon them? For we have no might to stand against this great company that is coming against us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. Okay, now let's start going into the whole message. In your business, in your family, in your whatever, in your church, in your finances, there's battles. There's stuff raging against you. There's stuff that feels like, Lord, I don't know what to do about this financial thing. God, I don't know what to do about this business deal. God, I don't know what to do about this promotion. God, I do not know what to do with this application. God, it seems like everything is against me. Lord, I don't know. I've put in this application. It seems like everybody gets it except me. Oh, God, how many has got battles? Here comes Jehoshaphat. He says, oh, God, we really don't know what to do. How many times have you stood and said, Lord, I don't know what to do? He says, but our eyes are on you. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 2 says, with the eyes on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, we got to run this race. And what's going to happen? We're going to come out on the other side with flying colors. You got to get your eyes on Jesus. Look away from the situation, the circumstance. What is the situation? The thing you look at. What is the circumstance? The circle you stand in. So what do? Step out of the circle. Look away from the situation. Look to Jesus. Okay, let's read on. Verse 14. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehaziel. Verse 15. He said, hearken all Judah, you inhabitants of Jerusalem and you King Jehoshaphat. The Lord says this to you. I'm speaking. Be not afraid. Same as Exodus 14. Or dismayed at this great multitude. For the battle is not yours, but God's. Everybody say out loud right now. You've got to get the word. The battle is not mine. Everybody, the battle is not mine. Everybody, the battle is not mine. The battle is the Lord's. Say, the battle is not mine. The battle is the Lord's. Okay. Tomorrow, go down to them. Behold, they will come up by the ascent of Ziz, and you will find them at the end of the ravine before the wilderness of Jeruel. You shall not need to fight in this battle. Okay, I see there's a few people that really hear what I'm trying to say. I'm speaking as a prophet of the Most High God. God says, you shall not need to fight in this battle. I don't care if you're fighting cancer, if you're fighting sugar diabetes, if you're fighting HIV, if you're fighting a marriage situation, if you're fighting a work situation, a boss situation, an employee situation. I don't care if you're fighting a raise situation, a bonus situation. I don't care if you're fighting a church split and a church situation. God says to somebody today that has the ears to hear, the battle is not yours, the battle is the Lord's. You will not have to fight in this battle. You shall not fight in this battle. You shall not fight in this battle. Take your positions. Here it comes for the second time. Stand still. Here it comes, and see the deliverance of the Lord. Somebody must shout now. Thank you, thank you. Who is with you? Oh, Judah and Jerusalem. Here it comes another time. Bless you, little man. Fear not. Come on, preach. Nor be dismayed. Tomorrow go against them. Here it comes. Bless you. For the Lord is with you. And what happened? They fell on the ground and worshiped God. And some Levites, verse 19, of the Kohathites and Korahites stood up and praised the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. God will fight for you. The battle is not yours.
I just want to bring in here, verse 20 says, believe in the Lord your God, so shall you be established. Believe in his prophets, so shall you prosper. And we've always taken that, singled it out, but it's in this context that
it says
we must believe God.
We've got to believe him. Got to believe him. Got to believe God. Got to believe the prophet that is speaking for the Lord. God will fight. The battle is not yours. You shall not fight. And what did they do? They praised God with a loud voice. What did God say? You will see the deliverance of the Lord. And they rose early in the morning, went out in the wilderness to Koah, and they went out. Jehoshaphat stood and said, hear me, O Judah, and you inhabitants of Jerusalem. Believe in the Lord your God, and you shall be established. Believe and remain steadfast to his prophets, so shall you prosper. And when he had consulted with the people, listen to this, they appointed singers to sing to the Lord and praise him in their holy priestly garments. And they went out before the army, saying, give thanks to the Lord, for his mercy and loving kindness endure forever. The Lord is good. And his mercy endureth forever. Oh, the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Oh, the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Listen, and when they began, if somebody just can get it, when they began to sing and to praise, the Lord said, ambushments against the men of Ammon, Moab, Mount Seir, who had come against Judah, and they were self-slaughtered. Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! Your battle. You don't have to fight. The Lord will fight for you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Woo! Wow. In other words, I will not be able to stop the blessings. I will not be able to stop the deliverances. I will not be able to stop the peace coming to my home. I will not be able to stop the joy that will be in my house, the happiness, oh, the victory in my family, in my work, in my church, in my business, oh, the prosperity in my finances. Hallelujah. Bless, 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 bless. This is where you're supposed to run and throw money, man. Bless you. The Lord will fight for 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 you. Hepra shika tu kura mahata. Sheka la mahotoro mongalata. Bless you. Hey, that pig you got married to, you bore. You didn't hear that. that pig you got married to, you bore. How can you say he's a pig? Then you're a sheep pig. You married him. Doves doesn't marry pigs. You think you're that holy dove. How can you acknowledge your husband as a pig if you're a holy dove? How do you have a marriage act? Too tough now, eh? Yeah, you should listen between the lines. God is just saying the battle is not yours, the battle is not the Lord's. You shall not fight. The Lord is going before you. He will fight for you. I don't care what type of battle it is. God says, hold your peace, stand still, stay at rest, come unto me. If you labor and I have led, you shall find rest for your soul. Somebody's got to break the cycle of fights. Somebody's got to enter the rest. The promise to enter the rest is still standing. Who's going to enter the rest? Somebody need to enter the rest. And I, for one, stand up and say, Lord, I want to enter the rest. Praise the Lord. For the Lord is good, and his mercy endureth forever. Break that cycle. Break that cycle. Break that cycle. Break that cycle. Break the cycle. Break the cycle of fights. Break the cycle of fights. As a little child, I'm speaking to you now. As a little child, I'm speaking to everyone now. As a little child, could you handle it when your parents were fighting? What did it do to you? Come on, be serious. How much of that stuff do we carry around, bless you, to the next generation? To the next generation? To the next generation? And we don't even know we're carrying it on. We got to acknowledge that something's wrong. Otherwise, we would have had total joy and peace. So somebody's got to stand up and say, I will break the cycle. But my children are now grown up. So then they break the cycle. And what about me? I break it too. But I'm already great, great, great grandfather. I've got 2011 great, great grandchildren. Break it. You do not know what power you have if you can enter the rest. Maybe it'll fall down into four generations that are alive before you, and you will see your little grandchildren be at peace. I'm going to do a series again on child upbringing without the rod. With a correction of the Word of God. Instill it to them when they wake up. When they wake up, say, listen to what the Word of God says, my little baby. Read, thus saith the Lord God to this little child, you are, read, read. Read. Carry them and prophesy over them. I spoke to Chrissy today in the car on the way to Pochestrum, went to eat with Tracy. It's her birthday tomorrow. And so the whole family went to eat out with them. On the way, I said, you know what, Chrissy? When you were the age of your daughter, Katie, this is what you said. Daddy, play Gospel Road for me. It's a movie of Johnny Cash of the life of Jesus. Gospel Road, made in 1969. When he was a baby, we used to play that movie, the video in our house. And Chrissy wept. At the age of two, when he started speaking, she said, Gospel Road, Daddy, Gospel Road. So I had to put Gospel Road in. And he would sit in front of the TV weeping. Yeah, over and over. When it's finished, he come crying, Gospel Road, Daddy. We put it in again. true. I said, now what do our children ask for today? Mickey Mouse, Mickey Mouse. It may sound stupid, but why don't they ask for Gospel Road? And I said, let's go to the video shops and get Christian videos, children's videos. On our shelves, there are plenty. We should put it in a library that people can take it out and go show your children Christian movies. Did you know Tom and Jerry kill each other all day long? They scream and fight morning till night. I'm serious. And the little babies fight. Hey, it may sound stupid. The little comic strips fight all the time. Yeah, I don't say don't show it to them. Annalise says, you know, Jerry is demon possessed. Yeah? I like Tom and Jerry myself. Yeah, Winnie the Pooh is not too bad, you know. Oh, bother. Can I have some honey? Oh, bother. You know, Tigger. T-I-G-G-E-R, Tigger. They're not too bad. But what do we show our children? Do we instill the word when we wake up, when we walk by the wayside, you know? Prophesy over them at nighttime. All three my sons, there's my wife, every night without exception. Prayed till they fell asleep, and when they were asleep, I prophesied over their beds. I wake up in the night, I walk over there, I said, Kubis, you will be a man of God. You preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. You are called and chosen of God. You will be a musician. You will lead millions in worship. You will be a man of God. Petrus, you will be a man of God. You will be a true prophet of the Most High God. Till they left the house. Yeah, till they left the house. I mean, just before they got married. They were big men and they were sleeping in our house. I went and prophesied over their beds. You know, some nights it wasn't too good an experience. One night, Quizzy woke up and nearly killed me. But who's there? Who's there? What are you doing here? I said, hey, it's me. It's me. He's now bigger and stronger than me. He jumped up and he ran for me. I said, hey, it's your dad. I'm praying for you. I'm prophesying over you. Who's that? I'm glad you're enjoying it. And we nearly killed Johan one night. I couldn't wake him up. I thought he dozed off and he had two earphones in his head playing so loud. Fell asleep, snoring, you know, and broke down his whole door to get in there. I'm talking to you, Johan. Okay, forget it. We're busy with the word. Let's go to Ephesians 6. We're going to pick up the same story of Exodus 14, 2 Chronicles 20. The very same story is in Ephesians chapter 6. The very same story is in Ephesians 6. New Testament, Apostle Paul. This is going to rock a few boats today. 10, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That you may be able to do what?
Stand.
Able to do what?
Stand.
Able to do what?
Stand.
Amen.
Not fight. Stand. Psalm 24 says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. They that dwell therein. Psalm 104 says, the earth has been given to mankind. Heavens are heavens for the Lord. Blessed are the meek, they shall inherit the earth. So this earth is ours. God said to man, I've given you authority and dominion, rule on this earth. Subdue it. So the earth is ours. So why do we have to fight for the earth? We just need to stand our ground. And when the devil comes, we stand and say, ah, it's not your earth. Ah, your peace is disturbed. It's not your peace. You don't fight, you just keep your stand your ground. God already said, go take the land. So he just said, stand. He already said, this is your property. Stand. They didn't have to fight. They didn't have to fight. They didn't have to fight. God did the fighting for them. How would you like God for a change to fight the battle on your behalf? Get the devil off of your back. Right? We are not wrestling with flesh and blood, contending with physical opponents, but against despotisms, against powers, against the master spirits who are the world rulers of the present darkness, against the spirit forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural. Man, that sounds bad, man. That sounds like there's a lot of things against you. But verse 13 says, therefore, put on God's complete armor. Now listen to the rest. That you may be able to resist. 1 Peter chapter 5, James chapter 4, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Humble yourself in the sight of God, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Okay? Resist. Stand your ground on the evil day of danger. And having done all the crisis demands to stand. Stand therefore. Hold your ground. Having tightened the belt, okay. See anybody in the house? Yes. So what must I do? Stand. 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 5 times in Ephesians 6. Stand. Come on, somebody say amen. From verse 10 right through verse 14. Stand, 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 stand. He didn't say fight, 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 fight. So many Christians fight so many devils. You would think that, you know, that all they have to do is fight devils morning till night. When the devil is out of the washing machine, he's in your car. When he's out of the car, he's in your child. When he's out of your child, he's in your wallet. When he's out of your wallet, he's in the bank manager. When he's out of the bank manager, he's in your teacher. When he's out of the teacher, I mean, everybody's got a devil. And you're forever fighting. How would you like to hold your peace, stay at rest, cast your cares on Jesus, come to him because you labor and are heavy laden, find rest for your soul, stand and see the salvation of the Lord. Praise the Lord. The battle is not yours, the battle is the Lord's. I'm not going to fight my wife. I'm not going to fight my husband. I'm not going to fight my children. Why do we bring children in the world to forever fight them? Why do we marry a wife to forever fight her? Why do we marry a husband to forever fight him? Why do you find a job to forever fight against the job? I mean, is there anybody that can hear? Listen to this. He says, put on the breastplate of truth and loins girded about truth, breastplate of righteousness. Okay, let's read it. Verse 14, King James. Stand therefore having your loins girded about with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness. Listen to what he says. Your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you'll be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked. Take the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. If I pray in an unknown tongue, I pray in the Spirit, and I do not know what I pray, but by the Spirit I speak mysteries. Supplications and intercession for all the saints. So I learn meekness. I get rest from Jesus. I say what God says. I praise the Lord. I pray in the Spirit. I have my eyes on Jesus. I make intercession for all the saints. I see the salvation of the Lord. I get victory and I stay blessed. I am blessed. I am blessed. They sang it in the 70s. Every day of my life, I'm blessed. When I get up in the morning till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed. Somebody said, oh, these faith people, they always say, blessed, blessed, blessed. You know, they say what you say is what you get. It's funny what they say they get. You can curse Copeland, but he's got what he says. He's rich, he's got a few jets, and he's got a big house, and he's happy, and all his children serving God, all his grandchildren are serving God, all his great-grandchildren are serving God. And so with Brother Hagin, all in the ministry with him. But somebody set an example, say what God says. Believe the word. They didn't get the same gospel was preached to them, but the word was not mixed with faith. They didn't say what God says, they said what the situation says. What will happen if we all start saying what God says? Or look at that. No. God says. Imagine. I know it's not going to be easy. What's going to happen after a week if we all decide we're going to say just what God says? Hey. But who's going to fix this if we're going to say what God says? God. Somebody's got to put their hand to the plow. Now put your hand to the plow without fighting.